Steve, you may want to introduce yourself. These guys are all yours. And if anybody wants to talk to me about anything, their deliverables or something, I'll be in the back here holding office hours and action.
Okay. Well, great. Well, thanks, everybody, for having me here. Thanks, Dr. Souza. So I'm Stephen Parlett, and I essentially have spent 25 plus years as a professional money manager, both in long-only mutual fund institutional money management contracts, as well as over 13 years at a very large hedge fund. So just real quick about my background. Graduated with a finance degree from Cal State Sacramento way back in 1991. Immediately kind of launched a career into the mutual fund area, getting my start as a portfolio accountant, becoming the first junior analyst at that firm, and essentially about 5 years later, got promoted to be a co-portfolio manager of a $1 billion mutual fund specializing in global telecom, media, and technology stocks. Invested essentially all around the world with that fund. Then in 2004, I switched from long only to being the hedge funds and was the primary, essentially, telecom, media, and internet analyst at Citadel, investing in Asia markets, United and North American markets. A few years later, had my own team, since a team of five individuals were managing about a $3 billion fund, long, short, neutral equities. Very concentrated portfolio construction to bet on essentially stock risks. And just left the business about a year ago, and has since been doing some private investing, doing some fintech startups, a couple of strategic advisory panels on in financial market type things, and a nice introduction to St. Mary's through coaching the CFA Research Challenge at Mary Ellen Jacob. We're on the team, had a little 6 hours plus of working with them, which was a great experience. And I guess they're going to be presenting their report this afternoon to the Finance Club, if anybody's interested in doing that. So what I'd like to do in briefly, and I spent a little over almost an hour and a half yesterday with the investments course talking about portfolio construction, very much in a practical context. So I know we'll leave the academic side to the textbooks and everything that you're learning here. I'm going to kind of take that into a little more of a real world example. And I'll really streamline that a little bit for today. I know this is an international portfolio finance class, and so kind of bring in the international components and some of the experience that I had there and why it's important to look at some different different angles. So with that, and then I should say we'll have some small breaks for Q&A, and if anybody wants to talk to me about kind of the career path, any other details or advice around careers in this field, happy to talk to you after class briefly or give you my contact information, we can talk about it later. So portfolio, when you think about portfolio construction, think about risk. There's two sides of things, right? Are you picking the right securities, and in this case, we'll mostly talk about stocks that are going to outperform, on some basis going forward. Everything that you will see in analyzing the historical performance of the security really doesn't tell you anything, in my view, about how it will perform in the future, right? Past performance does not equal future performance. However, the information that you can gather by studying that security's behavior, its risk behavior, its industry behavior, and it's what we're going to talk about as style behavior, has a lot to do with its risk profile going forward. And any financial product is basically a fraction. It's the return divided by the risk. Return doesn't necessarily mean a lot unless you can also measure the return. Any sophisticated asset allocator is going to be looking at the combination of the two things. So they're both very important. It's not good enough just to put up a market-beating returns. If you've taken too much risk to get there, it'll eventually catch up with you, and a good asset allocator knows that. Okay, so essentially, where there's the risk side, and then there is the essentially factors to a security. Risk eventually is going to be measured by volatility, which it also can be measured as beta, right? So if a stock has a 30% volatility in any given year, it moves up or down 30%, that's going to be a higher risky stock than a stock that has a stock volatility of 15%. That is measurable over any period of time. The beta, which I'm sure you know, is how it behaves against the appropriate index. If it's got a 1.2 beta, it outperforms by 20%. Or underperforms by 20%, if the market's up 10%, it should be up 12 over averages. If the market's down 10%, then it'll be down 12%. So that's always a starting point, and I think that's what most people think about and realize. What I want to add to this is that you should be really thinking about risk. This is kind of the, this is the one-dimensional view. What I talked about yesterday was really taking it into a three-dimensional view, thinking risk, with industry and with style, and really in this course we'll talk about it, I guess, more as a square or a cube, and because we're going to add country, and with country comes FX to the element. So we've got industry, style, country. In this case, actually, I probably would put country there as in terms of its importance. So really quickly, as when you think about industry, there's something called, and you'll see this probably as you break things down, there's a GICS code, which is standardized industry classifications. You start with a sector, and so like your self-care might be healthcare.
You guys should be taking notes and then put that in your midterm.
Okay, so this is one example here. Then you'll essentially have it an industry. So this could be pharmaceuticals. And then you'll have a sub-industry. And this could be biotech. I'm choosing an area I really know nothing about, but it's a good example of essentially as you can kind of roll through things through. So, and the important here is knowing that, okay, so if stocks are a member of this sector, then they're going to behave similarly to other stocks within the sector. As you move through, you'll get more granularity and you should get a tighter correlation between what the industry or the sub-industry belongs to versus something else. So for example, if you're going to take, if this is, we're talking about, say, United Healthcare, which is a giant services-oriented defensive, you know, business, or we're talking about Sage, you know, Pharma, which is a biotech, then they both belong to the same sector, but how many times is this stock and this stock really probably going to behave in the same way? Probably very little, right? They just have different growth characteristics. Everything else is going to be a little bit different about it. So, and then some stocks, if they're big and diversified, like a Disney or Berkshire Hathaway or General Electric, something else that, you know, that could have some components, and you might put a weight to it. Well, it's 50% in this industry, 50% in this industry. You doesn't mean you have to completely choose. Now, the reason this is important is because when you're selecting stocks, if you're in the internet industry, or you say you're in internet advertising, that's the company membership. That's new, right? You're probably what the management's doing. What the products that are being developed are going to have a lot of idiosyncratic impacts to how the company's operating, because it's not quite as much as what your competitor's doing at the same time. Whereas if you take something like the energy sector, right, you're an oil driller, and everybody's got access to the same technology, but supply-demand components is really what is impacting the oil price. Like what's really going to be the outcome for the earnings of that oil driller? It's the commodity price. So the commodity price is going to have a similar amount of impact to every other driller in that same sector. So that's why it's important to think about and measure what industry something belongs to and what essentially the correlations that are gonna be there.
There's some more.
Yep.
Fry markers right there.
All right, so that's the industry component. The country component, oh, let's go to stylish. So the style component is essentially what behavior type characteristics that a company is going to have. So if we look at style, this could be, these are some examples. So you have growth, you might have value, you might have a dividend yield, you leverage. Size, and we just go with those for now. So essentially, there's quantitative like Barra, there's other services that essentially have already done this essentially for professional investors where you could build your own risk model. But so we already kind of talked about a company is going to, what is going to predict the stock returns over and above your brilliance as being a stock picker, right, and doing the individual company research. It's going to be, you know, what industry do they belong in? If they're in the biotech industry and the FDA all of a sudden comes out with really tight, much tighter requirements for lab trials and things like that to get a drug approved, every biotech company is going to go down that day, right? Because it's going to take longer to get their drugs to market. It's going to be more expensive to get to the drugs to market. So no matter who had the best drug, the development pipeline or not, they're all going to go down that day because that was a industry risk that happened. And so that's something that needs to be measured within a portfolio context. How much industry risk do I have with this? So now we're talking about the style risk, whereas a company is going to generally be a growth stock if it's growing faster than the market. And this is all relative to the universe at which you're selecting. So if you're looking at only companies in Great Britain, then you can have, you know, that portfolio measured on what's the highest growth stocks that are traded on the London Stock Exchange, and the slowest, you know, or negative growth stocks that are, one would be have a higher weighting, one would have the negative weighting. So it's all within the context of the universe. And so if you're thinking about globally, you want to think about what the appropriate index is, or universe really, that you're considering. You can come back to that a little bit. So you're gonna have, if something's a growth stock, if something's a value company, this is a mature, steady company, high assets, low price to book, dividend yield obviously attracts a certain set of investors that want to have a dividend yield stock. So whether money is flowing in or out of dividend, you know, people view dividend yield stocks to be more or less attractive relative to the index at any point in time. So these are, oh, I know, I don't want to have it on here, momentum. So these essentially are behavior. If sales and earnings growth is fast, if it's slow, if its dividend yield is higher or lower than the market, if the leverage is the stock on the balance sheet, right? This is important if you're carrying a lot of debt versus if somebody has no debt, somebody has net cash, interest rates are moving around, that's going to impact how the stock behaves. Again, these are kind of like in absence of any other company news, other things. These are just, you know, a general characteristics of how it acts. Size and market cap. Small caps will behave differently in certain types of market environments than large caps will. And then, so again, this is just easily quantified by its market cap relative to its universe. This essentially is price momentum, and this has a lot to do in the stock market in terms of, If a stock's already outperformed its peers or underperformed its peers, it has positive momentum, it has negative momentum, and there's a lot that can be done around measuring the risk there. If you have a portfolio that has a lot of momentum, for example, on it, that means it's already performed. You know, with the risk of a portfolio that's already performed over the course of 6 months, maybe you were just brilliant and had 80% of your stock picks were right, or maybe you got a little lucky and your luck's about to turn, right? It's going to come through. If I think about a baseball analogy, right? If a really good hitter is going to hit 300 and if they hit 450 for 2 months, is it more likely they're gonna hit 250 for the next 2 months, or are they gonna hit 450 for another 2 months? So you can kind of get that reversion. And so then you essentially take various companies, and I'll take some domestic companies. Just as an example here, like say a Google or an AT&T, and they'll have different weighting. So it's like usually +3, -3. Again, it's all relative. So, you know, Google's a growth company. It might have a 2 relative to the universe. It might be a -2 in terms of value because it's all growth and growth businesses, not a lot of assets. It has it doesn't have a dividend yield. So this is actually a -2. A dividend yield, think about it, it's all relative. So if the index you're looking at has a dividend yield of 2%, then it's gonna be essentially a 0. And if they have a higher than that, you'll have a positive loading or a negative loading. Leverage, there's no leverage here. So that's gonna be a -3. It's a huge company. So that's gonna be a very price momentum. It's done pretty well. Maybe this is a 1.5. I'm just making these numbers up generally from just watching these stocks recently. AT&T is a low growth company, so you're gonna get a 2. It's very cheap, so it might be a +2. It has a very high dividend yield, so this might be a 3. It has very high leverage, bought Time Warner, so this might be a 3 or a 2. But it's a huge company, lousy stock. So here you kind of, and you just go on and on with this, and you essentially have a big matrix of the weightings of these securities in your portfolio times all these loadings. And you see, if you had a portfolio of two companies, this has very low style risk because the style components that Google has are mostly offset by the style components that AT&T has. So if you just had these two stocks in your portfolio, you essentially have kind of hedged out style risk, right? So whatever these styles are doing should be that, and so that's essentially, but obviously two stocks don't make a portfolio, you're gonna be 30, 40, hundreds of stocks goes up. However, there's one area that you're gonna be exposed to, right? So size. So if there's money flowing into away from large caps and into small caps because of any certain economic environment that favors smaller companies, growth companies, then this portfolio would look to underperform all else equal. And so when you're looking at the rest of your securities, you may want to look for some smaller cap stocks to put in there. Okay. So yeah.
When you're building that model, are you using principal components analysis? Are you using Z scores? Are you using cross-sectional regression? What kind of quant techniques are you using?
I believe it's more on the Z-score regression side of things in terms of when these models are put together, because there's obviously, some of them are just absolute elements, right? You know, they're just very measurable. Okay, what's the dividend yield, you know, of the company versus the dividend yield of the universe that it's being compared to? And it's almost just a rank ordering. You put it into sevenths or something, and then there's some of it where they're looking at backtesting historically in terms of, you know, as growth outperformed or underperformed, did these companies have that similar growth to it? But ultimately, this was for the quants. This was for the data quants and the BARA and MSCI and some other things and more things that I would, and so, and this goes on for like another 6 style factors. What I would do as a portfolio manager in practical application is this would be delivered to me, and I would say, you know what, this value loading is wrong because there was an M&A deal here, and they wrote off some goodwill, and so it took down their book value, and that's not really reflective, and here's the other industry companies that are similar in the industry, and I would essentially write something up to the risk team and say, here's why this loading is wrong. I know these stocks. I know the universe of which it operates in. Here's my proposal. You know, like a 95% hit rate, or they would change it. Because there's being blind to the numbers and the quant, and then there's, you know, because there's exceptions. There's always going to be exceptions to every rule. There's going to be something that's missing within the data that you need to go back over. Okay, so that's the the industry and style. Country is obviously fairly self-explanatory. You obviously, I think you have to think about this in a few different contexts. One is developed versus EM, emerging markets. Really different here. And obviously there's some countries that are making transitions from developed market, from emerging markets to developed markets, but I think they're very much within the context of international investing, two different asset classes that really have two different sets of risk components. So that's one thing you want to think about, to the degree that you can keep these separate rather than commingle it is important. And then obviously you can, you know, have region and country. Okay, so this is fairly self-explanatory in terms of why you would essentially do the same thing for a country and find out, you know, what's the membership, right? What country should this belong to? And on a more advanced basis, you could take a global company and say, well, they do a certain amount of business in this country, a certain amount of business in this country, a certain amount of business in that country. By and large, the company is going to behave more to where it's actually traded, where its stock listing is going to be, really, because that is going to put it in that universe, and that is going to essentially what's going to drive investor behavior around that. So why is country risks important? Number one, country risks are going to be important for foreign exchange. Anytime, backing up a little bit, when you're, again, going back to stock picking context, you're doing the research, you're analyzing the products, you're analyzing the management team, you're analyzing their assets, you're doing all this very specific stock research, what is outside management's control? That's what you want to think about as risk, because those are the same risks that are going to surprise them, but the same risks that are going to surprise you as an investor. So how the foreign exchange has two elements. If you're a dollar-based fund, then if a Vodafone in the UK essentially has, I don't know what the share price is right now, let's say it's £200, and the currency is going plus or minus, this is what equals your US value of the security, which you're going to price in the mutual fund to investors. So if this is changing, then the performance of Vodafone is changing outside of, to a dollar-based investor, outside of the fundamentals of Vodafone in the markets in which it operates. Now, this can be hedged, but that equals a cost. So point being, if you can pull up a portfolio, if you can have a portfolio that's diversified over enough currencies that things are going to be moving up or down enough, you may decide that hedging is not worth the cost of that hedge. And different countries, hedging the Japanese yen or the British pound, as you might imagine, is a lot cheaper than hedging the Indian rupee or something else that might be less liquid and more volatile. The other reason here is the company competitiveness. So if you're looking at a company that is in an industry that it competes globally, and they're essentially using the same underlying technologies, commodities, so forth. If they cannot price the product in their home market because the input price is in one currency, they'll have to price it in a different currency in their home market, or they're exporting it on a global basis. You could have different competitive issues between if you happen to be in one country versus another, and the FX is foreign exchange is changing amongst those companies. So you essentially can get underperformance or outperformance of a stock just by luck because of what is happening with the foreign exchange. Foreign exchange is a very difficult thing to forecast and predict. I don't think it's it's, I don't know that anybody does it well. It's increasingly political, where people want to appreciate or depreciate their currency to get their juice up their various GDP forecasts, things like that. And so, again, it has to be viewed, I think, foreign exchange has to always be viewed as a risk and not as a return opportunity. And so that goes back to, if we're going to assess risks, then you need portfolio construction that takes your stock selection, the security selection, what you want in there, and then you need to go back and measure, just like you're going to measure, okay, or are we really overweight this industry versus another? Are we really overweight or underweight a certain style factor versus another? Are we really overweight or underweight a certain country with FX? Because that is another risk that could hit us. We don't want to go out of business because of things that we're leaving to randomness, right? As somebody that is constructing portfolios for their clients, they don't get a business. You don't want to lose your job if you had, if you were really right on picking the stocks, but it was all this other stuff that caused you to underperform. Guess what? They're just going to be measuring, for the most part, the bottom line, and say you're a good stock picker, but you're a bad portfolio manager, risk manager. You need to be both.
Where do you get the, are you guys building your own currency factor models? Are you buying that information? Are you guys, doing your own, forward curve, interest rate, inflation rate differentials, political stability? Mm-hmm. I mean, do you buy that stuff, or are you guys building up those models?
In the case of long-short equities, we were just flat out hedging every country to zero. So we were just not going to take any currency. So all the FX exposures from this example were hedged out. If you had, for example, you'd have the euro and the pound. If you had a portfolio in Europe, if those were mismatched, they would just go out and flat out hedge it to zero rather than take any kind of direct view. And we would also essentially, by using indices, so if we were a little overweight Japan, underweight Korea, we'd essentially just use the index and to beta neutralize that exposure. The actual FX exposure within the company for the competition, that was left up to the analytical research team, right? So good example, company I cover is American Tower. American Tower has a big business in Mexico, big business in Brazil, big business in India, some in Europe. And so my model on American Tower would always have a live feed in it for the FX rate, what was going on there, because there wasn't necessarily hedge. What I would also do, though, is I'd also understand by all my conversations with the company, reading the K's and Q's, where the mismatches are. So they may have had, they may be in a certain country, but they may have in their contracts that they're pricing it in dollars to the telecom companies that are on those carrier towers, but their local costs in terms of leasing the land that's under the towers or providing backup generators and things like that, those might be in local currencies. So you always had to kind of measure that. And so I would always be watching the kind of a matrix of currencies, and I would generally be ahead of the market who wasn't watching this closely to sit there and say, wow, these currencies are going, like, they're going to miss their earnings just from FX. Now, I would consider that a lower quality reason to trade versus something shifting within the industry or something shifting within management's control. But it's something to be aware of, and it's why stock picking is always a mosaic. It's always a combination of input factors and not any one factor.
To hedge off the equity market or the currency of the individual company risks, were you using futures contracts or option contracts?
Generally futures, yeah.
Futures contracts?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And then were you using option contracts on the individual companies?
No. If we were doing options on individual companies, it was entirely by way of a view of risks or certain catalysts. So it's off topic a little bit, but you can actually have four ways to make money on a company. You can choose to be long the company, you can choose to be short the company, you can also choose you can, so in either way, you're saying the company's overvalued or undervalued, right? You're making that assessment based on lots of things that go into it. What you can also assess is the option price overvalued or undervalued, which is basically based on the volatility of the stock. So if I think a company has just come out of a period of really high volatility because it just happened to get hit with a bunch of random stuff that happened within the industry, and it's created all this volatility in the stock, but I don't think it should be so volatile going forward, I could essentially short the option, right? Essentially, because I'm saying that volatility is now priced too high, it's gonna come down. If I'm right, then I'll make money essentially holding that option or closing that option throughout there. I could also, you know, there's all kinds of straddles and strangles and all kinds of things that it's not necessarily my area of expertise, but when I would use them, it was pretty fun. Because I remember one stock was super volatile because it was expected they were going to cut their dividend. And so, are they going to cut their dividend? Are they not going to cut their dividend? And then they cut the dividend. The stock was down 20%. Well, they cut the dividend and they instituted a buyback. And so once all that was done and all the funds that held it for its high dividend got done selling, and so all this volatile, the options were priced way up here. I'm like, okay, well, this is over. Like, they're not cutting their dividend again for another few years. And they're going to be buying back stock, which is going to dampen the volatility. And so I'm going to essentially, I think it's fairly priced, but I essentially put on a big straddle contract for 6 months that basically bet the volatility was going to collapse over the next 6 months. And it was great. It was a great trade. I always remember that trade. So back on topic here. So that's the country. Okay, so portfolio now is, it's talking about, given that your risk is going to be up against any given index, there's two ways to think about this. You're going to be, if you're essentially long only, kind of institutional, then you're going to have a benchmark. And that's what you're going to be measured against, right? So if the benchmark goes down 10% and your fund went down 8%, then you've outperformed by 200 basis points. Even though it's gone down, you're essentially, that's a win in terms of your client, you know, your client. The client's the one that chose that they wanted to be a lot, you know, in this asset class on a long-only basis. So, and vice versa, but it's, if you're up, If the index was up 10%, you were up 8%, you think feeling pretty good to yourself, hey, I made myself, my investors 8%. No, you were an underperformer. You essentially underperformed by 200 basis points. That client would have been better in a passive ETF type structure, just owning the benchmark. And then essentially there's absolute return, which essentially is more of a hedge fund, because you're essentially hedging those market risks. You're essentially committing that you're delivering a certain amount of return, let's just call it generally maybe a mid to high single digit number in all market environments, all FX environments, all stock market moving up and down. So if you returned 8% and the market, you know, the relevant market was up 20%, you actually still are a winner within because you delivered on 8%. If the market was down 5% and you delivered 8%, you're still a winner because you delivered 8%, because that's exactly what the asset allocator wanted from you. They wanted basically a steady number year in, year out, no matter what the market was going to do, and that therefore creates a good hedging component for them. So let's think about, because as you guys are, as I understand it, putting together and building portfolios, passive and active portfolios, you really have to think about a little bit about that benchmark. So then what the risks essentially are in that benchmark. So let's say one is, let's say Korea. So you have KOSPI is essentially the S&P 500 of Korea, and you are your stock selection. So now you've got Korean stocks, and your investment team essentially has said, well, we're gonna invest in, there's a cool gaming stock, and there's a services name, and there's a telecom, and we like this bank. Okay. And you did. And you're essentially saying, okay, well, and then you've got the beta, you know, the beta or the volatility component, this piece, and you've lined that up such that these, this portfolio is equal to the beta of the KOSPI. So you're like, okay, our stock picking is going to win out, and we're gonna outperform. What you have to be super careful of is what is in the KOSPI. Well, the KOSPI is dominated by semiconductors like Samsung, et cetera, and industrials. Think car companies, think POSCO, think you know, heavy machinery type things. So you're going to have a lot of risk, and so what you have to do is you have to really understand what's here, and go back to your research team and probably say, look, we can have some of these, but we're going to need to have some of these. If we want to, you know, if we want to, depending where our, you know, our risk tolerance is here, we need to be aware that the KOSPI is going to perform based on these industries, not these industries. And look, and semiconductors and heavy metal could also be influenced by the FX factors and everything else. So you need to be very cognizant of what is in the actual index. We're fortunate in the United States, the S&P 500 is a much more diversified index. As you go into country by country, what you're gonna find is much more concentrated indices. Therefore, the more you can have regional, you know, more like MSCI, Asia Pac, or MSCI developed European markets, and a better indices that have they're going to have more offsetting factors such that they're not going to get driven by a concentration here. And look, you can get creative. Like I was essentially, so I was investing in Asia. We were investing in, our mandate was to invest in telecom, media, and internet stocks in Asia. Well, you know, the indices weren't necessarily dominated by those industries. So what I tended to do was I grouped them into two, and I essentially put my Japan plus Korea into one grouping, because the index in Japan and Korea were pretty similar and behaved similar, such that I didn't have to essentially really squeeze my stock picking within one group. And I also recognized that Singapore and Hong Kong were dominated by property, banks, you know, more services companies. So you can create some larger universes in which to give yourself a little bit more operating room by figuring out the appropriate benchmarks. Okay, so putting all this together, right? You know, you're most, you know, as you're looking at the textbook, kind of the efficient frontier, you know, the capital asset line, that tends to be, you know, a focus within this area, and what's the right amount of diversification that you need to essentially get to have an efficient portfolio based on the covariance metrics and all the other stats. Essentially saying that is, you know, that's, you know, this part of it, that's one slice of the single dimension. In practical use, you're going to need to go beyond that and determine against your benchmarks. And in an absolute standpoint, this is essentially just that the pluses and the minuses offset each other, right, to equal something as close to zero as possible, is, you know, consider what sector, industry, sub-industry something belongs to, what style grouping something belongs to, what country something belongs to. Any questions so far on what we've covered there? Great.
I have a question.
Go ahead, Mary.
For research into companies like in countries like Japan and Korea where maybe their reporting isn't like, well, I guess if they're traded, would you buy stock? I guess my first question is, would you buy stocks that were traded in the markets here too? Because don't they have to, or they have higher regulations for what they have to put out for investors? Or would you go into their markets and buy there? And if you did, how would you figure out what's happening in the company? Like, some companies don't release as much information as like American companies or countries that are traded here.
Yep. So, that actually leads right into the next topic that I was going to talk about. From a starters, it's again back to that asset allocation game. There's diversification benefits from if you were running a high net worth family office and you only invested in U.S. stocks, you could benefit from diversification, from diversifying into international and emerging market stocks because they're going to behave differently. You could have some event that happened. We've seen it with the political changes, right, and how it's impacted stock market performance, positively or negatively. So you want to have international. So there, that's why it's a real asset class. In other cases, you have investors' money that are in that country, right? So if you're a British citizen, then you're taking FX risk by investing in U.S. stocks, which could be a reward also. But to get into, I thought, you know, in the class yesterday where I talked about a little bit on intrinsic valuations, wanted to talk about essentially stock selection, equity stock selection in international markets, since it's an international class. So I found, again, so this is as an anecdote. So I had two parts of my portfolio at Citadel. We had two-thirds, three-quarters of the team were dedicated on the domestic side of the portfolio, and some of us would go into both markets, and then we had about a quarter to a third of the portfolio in Asia. So and we do this on an absolute return strategy, right? So it didn't matter if the indexes were going up or down, didn't matter if the foreign exchange was going up and down. I had essentially have basically the same number of long ideas, the same number of short ideas within the industries that were my area of expertise to make money for our investors. And for 12 straight years, I made money every year in Asia. I'm not from there, I didn't speak the language, but I got on a lot of planes. Whereas in the US, I think I made probably money, you know, 3 out of 4, 4 out of 5 years across the team. So in my view, there's more opportunity, there's more edge to be had, and particularly in this now world of passive versus active strategies, where you're just getting so much fund flow into ETFs. And what is ETFs based on? This, 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 and this, right? It's just taking, you know, if fund flows are going to go in the S&P 500, you're going to own a lot of Amazon, you're going to own a lot of Google, you're going to own a lot of Bank of America, you're not going to own very much Grubhub, you're not going to own very much, right? So it's entirely, you're basically saying for most ETFs, I'm just basically betting on the size factor because I'm going to own the most of the big companies and the least of the small companies. And because it's cheap and efficient and there's a lot of good reasons for it, but you're taking on a lot of size, style factor if you're an S&P index fund investor only. So therefore, it creates opportunities, right? It creates opportunities to find the large caps that are overvalued and the small caps that are undervalued or the mid caps or anything else that are less weighted and create those weightings. But on the international side of things, you have less passive activity going on within those places. You have generally less sophisticated investors in those countries. I'm going to make a lot of generalizations here. But as an American investor, as a US-based investor, going in and getting on a plane and seeing the product in a different environment, seeing on the billboards, going through the stores, talking to the management teams really appreciate, like, wow, you know, Mr. Professional, U.S. investor, flew all the way here to take an interest in my company, talk to my company. They're very engaging. As Marielle pointed out, you have different levels of disclosure, you have different levels of accounting. So then that's your opportunity to ask those questions, right? Find out what are the elements. You also can, once you're on the ground, you can see if you can get a meeting with the regulator. I invested in telecom. I would always meet with the Japanese telecom regulator, the Korean telecom regulator, the Chinese telecom regulator in each one of my visits to those countries, finding out what they're thinking. They're not getting me any inside information, but if they're saying, oh, we feel like this industry is not competitive enough, okay, you know, alarm bell's going off. They're going to try to do some things to introduce new competitors to that industry. That industry is going to become less attractive. Maybe I want to start looking for short ideas within that industry. So those are some of the reasons you can get over there. Once you've done that enough times, you can start, they know you, and you've shown up all those times, you can start arranging a conference call, you can send them emails, things like that. You try to do those initially, they're like, I don't know who this person is, I don't trust this person. But you can really get a lot of edge by going out there, working through those, and again, by doing detailed modeling and incorporating the foreign exchange components, things like that are very good. The other element where, just from my own personal experience, where we won is going in as industry experts. The U.S. is more set up that way, where people are sector experts. People are either a technology investor, they're a financials investor, they're a healthcare investor, and they've got that expertise because we have big, broad, deep markets. If you're a fund manager in Japan and you only have four telecom companies and five pharmaceutical companies and this, right, you're not gonna have an investment team that just covers six stocks. You're basically gonna have you're our small cap team, or you're our Japanese British growth team, or you're sitting in Hong Kong, you're gonna be our emerging markets team, you're gonna be our developed Asia team, and you're gonna be the generalist, and you're gonna pick stocks across industries. So I go in there, and they don't know half as much as I do about telecom and the internet. They know things about a lot of areas I don't care about, but I'm going to go in there, and because I've seen what happens as a third wireless entrant, think of like what T-Mobile has done in the United States over the last 4 years. There's a T-Mobile in every other country, right? There's somebody that was like the small market share guy who got a little bit more innovative and took share from the incumbents, from doing something a little differently. I've already seen how that operating leverage works and how that stock's behaved and the characteristics that made that successful. I can apply that knowledge to another country where I'm seeing that country's equivalent of the T-Mobile emerge. So I think that's the bulk of it. I think there's 5 minutes left, so happy to take more questions. Could hit a little bit on the other intrinsic value stuff, but probably there's a lot here. And I would say, driving up, that a lot of this will is obviously some advanced things that'll go, you know, over some of your heads. Some of it'll stick, some of it won't. I always found that when I had this, I remember my portfolio finance class in college very well, and how excited I was about it, and it was something that really got me excited about getting to be in this business. And I distinctly remember feeling like I was only getting about 2/3 of it, partly because we were having to learn how to put it all on a spreadsheet, and those things were just getting invented then. But then, you know, 5 years later, when I was in ICFA, I was like, this is it. And I dove into the more practical applications of it. Like, this is what we were talking about in that class. Now it's mostly coming together. And then I get to Citadel, and we start going through more advanced, you know, when I was at Montgomery, we were just barely looking at, okay, we're percent exposed to this versus percent exposed to that. And that was basically the end of the risk analysis. And then I went to Citadel, which is absolutely an industry leader in risk management. And it all started to come together, and you started to really understand how to apply the concepts and why it created superior returns and more consistent returns to the investor, which is why, you know, Citadel is now running, they're in their 27th year and, you know, managed 15 $1 billion in assets, probably could be bigger, except for there's only so much money you can put. They lever that up 3 times, so they're actually investing about $100 billion or $50 billion within the marketplace because of the of an absolute strategy, they could, you know, they could double if they could find enough homes for the thing without diluting their returns. So any questions or any other topics you want to hit? Yeah.
How much do you consider political risk when you're putting together a portfolio?
Huge, right? And that's exactly why it comes down to the country element of things. With over 20 years of doing this, I've seen a lot of things happen. So why was the best I had, I remember being having a few positions in Indonesia, and there was a coup, and the market dropped 20%, right? And so a telecom company in that market was down like 15-20% that day. Nothing changed, right, on the telecom company. Nothing changed on anything. What happened is the risk component, right, the amount of risk that an investor was willing to take to hold an Indonesian security skyrocketed. So, for me, without having a view on what's going to happen in the coup, I was buying, I was buying more of that stock down 15-20% because it's more likely to normalize and the volatility to come down. There was a coup in Thailand, right? There was all those types of political environments. Political, I think, is getting to be a bigger component. I just don't know how to handicap it. I mean, how well did the markets handicap Brexit and Trump's victory, right? I mean, you would think those have been pretty efficient. Right, huge markets, tons of months and months leading up to something, both got them wrong. So therefore, hedge, construct.
So that's what you would be doing, like if you go back maybe 6 months, a year, and you saw what was going on with the trade wars and the Brexit fallout.
Yeah.
You would be starting to apply more the derivative contracts to hedge off the currency. The equity risk and the individual company risk. What would you have been doing?
I think even better than that, you would have just been doing that ahead of anything starting to hit the newspapers, right, or thing, right? You just say, I don't know what's coming. By the time you've seen it, you've probably already taken the losses in terms of what the foreign exchange has done or the equity risk premia. Right, that's now been applied to that country. So, in my view, you construct portfolios in an efficient way and bet on what you want to bet on before you see any of that even coming.
What's the haircut that you have to take on applying the hedging strategies on your pre-fee returns or what is your net fee fee return, your net return, not only the hedging cost,
yes,
but also the fees. So what does the investor really get net, and how much is the hedging cost and how much are your fees that you're charging?
Well, that's a good question. The hedging cost, again, if you're hedging natively, right, so I'm essentially saying, look, I'm in Korean telecoms, I can't really hedge this with a cost fee. So if there's four Korean telecom companies that I would cover, I would essentially want to just be a stock picker, because if I had a long SK Telecom and short the KOSPI, I was taking all kinds of risk, and I was shorting the KOSPI, so that comes at a cost, to your point, and it might have not really even been helping me that very much. It's only going to help me a little bit of the way, not all the way. So I'm going to say I'm going to own SK Telecom, and I'm going to short an equal amounts Korean Telecom and LG Telecom. Even better is if I really like a short idea, then I'll just do all that short. If I don't like this one, maybe I'll just do the other three short and small weights, such that I've reduced the risk that I want to bet on from SK Telecom. But to your point, it all comes back down to the investor. And the investor, it's hard enough to be a stock picker and create alpha. The more that you have friction costs, hedging costs, and things like that will come down, is going to reduce returns, but it also can enhance returns, right? If you're on the wrong side of an industry style or country exposure, the costs at Citadel
for hedging style risk, they would actually create their own indices. Basically, it was almost like a mini mutual fund that was like only, so there'd be a basket that was only exposed to the growth factor, and all these factors were neutralized. And so if they found that their investment teams were getting offsides on growth, even within our, for example, like we give a range, so I could be 10% long growth factor, say. Well, if 7 out of 10 of my colleagues were also 10% long growth factor, they wouldn't necessarily say, hey, you guys ought to change things. They would just throw a hedge on the other side of that. And but that creates trading and friction costs, and there was a cost, you know, there was cost investors. So ultimately, it comes down to the management team to try to figure out, you know, what's the optimal returns, including some of these costs. And in a competitive industry such as asset management, if you can be at scale to reduce those costs, use better risk control, better quantitative modeling, better scale in terms of your trading against your counterparties, then obviously that's something that you ultimately win with.
Can you talk about fees really quick, and maybe compensation too?
So, gosh, fees are all over the place. Obviously, long only is smaller fees, a little bit less value added. The industry generally is set up such that it's a percent of assets under management. Okay, so you're going to make your money year in, year out. It's your proceeds multiplied by the amount of assets that you're managing. Again, if you're underperforming or outperforming in a perfect world, you're either gaining or losing assets. Unfortunately, if you're, say, Franklin down in San Mateo, and you're managing $1 billion, and the market was up 10%, your revenues just went up 10%. You may have underperformed, but your revenue over 10%. The same thing happens if you're down 10%. So those revenues can really get moved around, even though it's a steady fee. So
we're talking like 75 basis points.
Yeah, roughly. In a hedge fund model, generally you're paying a premium for the returns, and the hedge fund manager is going to be more incentivized because they're there for the absolute returns. So on this model, you're going to have, you know, maybe a 1-2% management fee, but then you're also going to have a, call it 15-30% performance fee. This is why when you see, you know, my old boss Ken Griffin buying a $280 million apartment in Central Park, it's not off of this. It's off of this, right? So you essentially have $10 billion, and you return a 10% return, right? You made $1 billion for your investors, and in gross, 800 is going to the investor, and 200 million is going to the hedge fund.
How much goes to the portfolio manager and how much goes to the analyst?
So I essentially, they'd shoot me if I told you that. I've got all kinds of non-compete and all these like non-disclosure agreements. But anyway, the basic premise is that, so my team, the way it was set up is essentially my team would get, so if I was of this billion, right, if my team, you know, was 50 million of it, then I would essentially get X percent, you know, of that, which is obviously something lower than what this number is. And I would have a bonus pool, and I would essentially pay my analysts what I've either kind of agreed to them based on their individual performance and their seniority or whatever, and then I would keep what was left. So essentially, in this case, it was like my own little business was inside a big business. Now, what happens if I lost 50 million? Well, probably fired. Go on to the next fund. But if, let's say if the hedge fund lost $1 billion here, what happens is, year plus one, you need to make this up. You are not going to collect this until you've made up the investor losses and then gained again. So you've got to perform, and that's why the investor is willing to pay this, because they only pay if they win.
Thank you, Steve, and we hope you come back. Anybody else want to be in here? Thank you.